I wish I was Miss Moneypenny at the end of this movie getting railed by a digital James Bond.
What the fuck was that? I've got notes on that. That's like a good two paragraphs. I thought the film
it's the
ended
main
on
thing
that.
It's the main thing I remembered from this movie being like, oh, that scene's going to pop up at any point and it's like a jump scare. Like,
where's it coming from?
My name is Carl.
My name's Oscar.
And this is who would watch this. I'm gonna. Well, there'll be no breath and pauses, so it's just boom, 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 boom. And people are gonna be like, "Oh wow, I guess I have a seizure."
I guess I'm dying. I gotta listen. We'll listen to the podcast and then take yourself to the hospital.
Listen to us on the way.
Yeah.
Love the idea of an ambulance driver turning us up when they're like, oh, this guy's not going to make it.
I'm just going to do a couple of laps. We'll just ride this out. I'm listening to my podcast.
I swear there's 4 minutes left in the podcast. I want to know about their palate cleansers. Just let me go around the block.
Which pretentious film do they watch this week? Ooh, they're different. Welcome to Who Would Watch This, the podcast where we watch a film, chat about the film, and then try and figure out who would watch this.
Today, we're discussing the James Bond classic that killed Pierce Brosnan's section of the franchise, and it had to get rebooted for the better. It's Die Another Day, which currently has a 6.1 on IMDb, a 2.4 on Letterboxd, and a 56% on Rotten Tomatoes. Oscar, what is the plot?
Sorry, I was on the bucket list IMDb, and it said, two terminally ill men escape cancer ward and head off on a road trip and a wish list of to-dos before they die. That's the bucket list plot. And Die Another Day's plot is James Bond is sent to investigate the connection between a North Korean terrorist and a diamond mogul who has funded the development of an international space weapon.
Well, given the option, I'll happily watch The Bucket List. If told me those two plots side by side, I'd be like, two old men dying? That's
Sign
a
me
film.
Up. Do they kiss? No? I'm out.
I was told this was Brokeback Mountain for seniors. What is this? Let's go back in time to a time when we hadn't watched the film and tried to predict who we thought would watch it. Okay, Oscar.
Yes.
James Bond was supposed to be coming out this month in Australia, but it's been postponed again.
When was it actually originally meant to come out? I remember right at the start of lockdown, they were like, hey, get ready for that James Bond film.
It was November
2019,
pushed to 2020 February.
Gotcha. So that original push was just like, we're not ready yet, give us 3 months.
Yeah, I think it was give us a little bit more time, and then it got stuck in this whirlwind. And now the rest of the world's getting it 6 weeks before us, because of our awful lockdown. I saw Dune just got pushed in Australia to December 6th, when it comes out October 16th everywhere else. And I was
honestly
like,
not too
cool.
mad about that, but more time to procrastinate reading the book, so I'm very chuffed.
Just read a graphic novel, man.
There's pictures. Oh, pictures. All right. I can get in on that.
Timothy Chalamet's The Hungry Caterpillar. He eats through the pages, and you can touch the fur. Is this the sandworm? It's gristly like a foreskin.
I do love those books. Is there a fluffy Timothy, though?
No, there's a fluffy James Brolin.
I'm out. Sorry.
It's a fluffy Helen Mirren.
Okay, I'm back in.
That's your reward at the end. It's her white hair.
What does Zendaya feel like?
Oh, God. She hasn't showered in weeks.
You can actually feel the smell. It's gross.
I don't know how they put that in the book, but you're like, oh, God, this whole section on her armpit is rank. No, but that is a good section.
Okay, let's pivot back to James Bond. So that's coming out. That isn't coming out. We're not going to see that for ages. Anyway, what do we think about rewinding 18 years?
Oh, so we're doing... Sorry. So we're doing, what's it called? Spy Month. That was where I was going with that.
Oh, yep. Gotcha. Oh, you're going to work Zendaya's smelly appendages into Spy Month? Go on. You figure it out.
Well, Zendaya's in the Vin Diesel film we're doing, so, you know.
Okay.
She's not.
Anyway, we're doing Die Another Day. I've not seen this James Bond film. I don't think I've seen a James Bond film before.
Casino?
Yeah. I think I've seen Moonraker. So, I couldn't give you an opinion on it. I've seen it.
The franchise does this great stuff where they when it started, it was like a bit silly and it got sillier. So then it gets more serious and then it gets too serious. So then they get silly again. And then they accidentally go too silly. And then they go back to being serious again. And then they get too serious. And then you get to whatever the one is before Die Another Day. And they're like, oh, well, it's the 40th anniversary of James Bond. We'll go back to being silly. And everybody's just like, I don't know. So I don't know if this is what we wanted. And so then it has to get rebooted again. It's almost like an abusive relationship tonally for the franchise.
It's just flip-flopping, you know, silly and serious. And I love that. Yeah, keen. All right, cool. Well, because I feel like, the new James Bond, we got what's it called? Casino Royale. Slaps.
Quantum of Solace.
Strange.
Skyfall.
Slaps.
Spectre.
Sucks.
Yeah. You know what? They've got this thing going where it's like every second one's really good.
Yeah. So, keen for this one. I don't think it's gonna... I don't know.
Do you not like, what's his face? Who's the guy that's making it? Kerry Juju Fuganagua?
Or is he dumb?
Did, like, True Detective and Beasts of No Nation and, Maniac? You seen Maniac with Jonah Hill and Emma Stone?
Yeah, okay. Well, then maybe it will be sick, but I guess it's
written by the Fleabag girl.
Stop it.
Yeah. Phoebe Waller-Bridge.
Stop it. She wrote James Bond.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't do my research, it shows. Well, they got my face. That sounds fantastic. I can't wait for that. I'm back on the hype train.
I'm optimistic.
I'm so excited.
I think it'll be good.
Fuck it, it's going to win an Oscar. It's going to win 10.
But yeah, Die Another Day, my favorite James Bond as a kid. I'm sure it's going to crush me in terms of how awful this film has become over time. From pieces of it, from what I remember, this movie is problematic.
To which nation or gender or...
Oh, it's a great swing pendulum of being, wow, this scene's sexist. Jesus, the scene got racist.
We were so close. It was just sexist. Why'd you bring in that, like, racial caricature? We were so fine.
To be in Hollywood in the early 2000s.
Oh, that was the golden age. The cocaine had worn out, but my God, the sexual allegations were through the goddamn roof.
Oscar, who do you reckon this movie's going to be for?
I think I already said 10-year-old Carl last episode, so I can't say that again. I'm going to say it. True James Bond fans love this one. If you got the nerdy DVD set, this is one that's been worn out in your DVD player. Your Blu-ray's been abusing this one. That's what I'll say.
Rewind the cassette because you're ready to play it again.
Carl, who do you think this is for?
If I recall, a lot of this movie takes place in an ice palace, so I'm gonna say it's for people that love an ice palace.
Okay, well, I've really got to strap in for this one. Hells yeah.
It's pretty nuts. I'm very excited you've never seen it before. I think we're going to go on a really emotional journey with this one.
I'm keen for an emotional roller coaster always. That's my fatal flaw. Carl, this film is strange. So strange. So many flaws. Everything's really weird. It feels like it's an Austin Powers film most of the time. Let's go into it. After that, you've said yourself it's a silly film. Where else should we start? North Korea. The silliest nation on earth.
I think that you know the movie's going to get off on a bad footing when it fucks up just doing the regular James Bond intro. And it's like, what if the bullet went through the other bullet hole? And you're like, that doesn't fucking make any sense. How'd you ruin this seconds into the film? How did you fuck this up? It's the one thing you have to do in a James Bond movie to begin.
I thought, I was like, oh boy, thank God, I can just skip this because nothing you can't fuck up the intro. And I went back, like, just in case. They fucked it up, so furious already. I had to write a note. Oh, how dare it.
I think tonally it also really sets up just how much CGI you're going to be like, it's that time in Hollywood when they were like, look at what we can do with film. And you're like, that doesn't look good, guys. God, please don't let this be.
Check
most
out the
of
Pixar boys. They made those toys go alive. I bet we can do that with James Bond. No, no, no. Don't. Just, you've nailed it.
I love that they were like, wow, the effects that we have nowadays, finally we can appropriately make James Bond surf. So you open with the big guns.
I like that was the default setting for like CGI. Just like, we can make them surf. Like, can we make James Bond surf? You bet your top dollar we can. We've got three of them.
I just got back from this great Shia LaBeouf film. It's called Surf's Up. You wouldn't believe what they can do with CGI nowadays. We're putting that in a Bond film. We're putting it with Chicken Joe. All right, let's do it.
Snorting cocaine. It's a mockumentary penguin film. You're gonna love it. It's gonna make twice its budget somehow.
Is Surf's Up a pretty good film? I forgot that was a mockumentary. What a creative idea for them to do a mockumentary for an animated film.
Very creative. I remember playing the video game only as a child, and it did not capture the mockumentary clever style. It was just a surfing simulator, so I can't comment, but
I love the idea they set up the game like, you're the cameraman, and they're like, you're doing a 13-hour day of recording. You don't get a break and your back hurts because the camera's heavy. And you're like, oh no, and you've just got to chase after penguins as they live their lives.
Hey, you've run out of battery and your SD card's filling up. You better export that. Oh, it went corrupted? Well, I guess you're going to have a pretty fucking bad day with post, aren't you?
Great, now we can only use everything from camera 2. Every angle's off. I hope you're happy. That was a safety shot.
You're not getting paid. I'll say it. Fuck you. Fuck you. Fuck you. We're not using a wide for a documentary. Are you insane? How are we going to capture the emotion, you fucking idiot?
12-year-old Oscar being like, Mum, I've already failed the game. I don't know what
it?
I did wrong.
No, we didn't keep the receipts. You're playing the penguin mockumentary game, and you're going to fucking learn how to play it.
Yeah, so they surf into North Korea. Famous for its surf? I don't know.
I was going to try and look that up. Couldn't find any surfing information about that. I guess there's waves. There must be. But this is the best way to get in. I can't say if it isn't, so I guess it must be. They've done their research, I can only assume.
Which I think is going to really equate to a lot of the movie.
Yeah, exactly.
We have no way of checking.
We have no way of checking, so therefore, we can only assume they've done their research, and we will lay our lives down and just be like, yep, that's fine, you guys have done the research, we haven't, so the film gets a pass. So these gnarly spies have weapons in their surfboards, which feels like a weird...
I don't think a surfboard can carry this much and then still function as a surfboard.
Yeah, fiberglass is, like, pretty much... It's just a flotation device. You put, like, a like heavy grenade in there, you're sinking.
Could you not think of a bigger moving target to run through a North Korean base with than a surfboard? The three of them running with surfboards for an infiltration is such a funny shot.
But it sets the mood so perfectly. You're like, oh no, we're in for this kind of film. In terms, the North Koreans, I'll say it now, very lazy guards. They should have spotted this. So this is pretty much the setup. Okay, this is why Pierce... This is the start of the movie. So Pierce...
Maybe. I don't know what's happening a lot of this film.
No, I haven't got a clue. Okay, it's pretty much North Korea. They're doing like a diamond trade with some people. Some people are trading diamonds for weapons. Is that correct?
Yeah, and the diamonds come in like a cute little lunchbox with compartments. It's adorable.
It's adorable.
It's an adorable way to transport them.
But there's a bit of a space under the compartments, which Mr. Bond... See, he gets the diamonds? How does he get the diamonds?
He just pulls a gun up. He's incredibly lazy in this film. It's like, oh, I guess I care.
Yeah, I guess I'll give me. So then he puts C4 in the diamonds and then pretends to be the person that's going to be trading the diamonds with the North Koreans.
Mm. It's always a funny thing, the concept of James Bond, because he always calls himself James Bond, so that in most sequences in any movie, everybody's always like, well, you're James Bond.
Yeah, never.
And so the gig's up.
Yeah, no, this was the first movie I've ever seen James Bond pretend to not be James Bond. I assume everyone knows who James Bond is, and in this film, they know who James Bond is mere seconds after he pretends to be the trade and deal.
They kind of change up who he is in terms of the beginning is like he's an international assassin when James Bond is a spy. He's not an assassin. He doesn't always go out of his way to be like assassinating people. It's not his goal.
I thought it seems like this film, they're like, hey, he is a loose cannon who's allowed to kill. I kind of get that's his role, like loosely, but it seems like he's really dived into this where it's like, I'm going to kill in any way I can think possible, and that's my character motivation. They're like, okay, but you're in North Korea. It's a bit politically dicey, to say the least.
I love the idea of, like, M with a cigarette being like, you'll surf in, you've got, they're not gonna know you. Who knows you in North Korea? You ever fucked a woman from North Korea? I didn't think you had. Surf in!
Then you're gonna get some C4, put it in the diamonds, see if I care. And see what happens, you know, you do you, fuck a woman if you can, you know, tick that off.
I love the idea if that was the debrief and James Bond then had to relay that to someone else, on the plane there I'd be like, I'm gonna fucking die, I'm gonna die, what plan is this, we're gonna surf into North Korea.
Have the manila folder open up, it's just James Bond fucking a North Korean, oh no, and James Bond like, don't worry, here's a surfboard, we're gonna nail this.
I love the whole idea is the reason James Bond gets caught is just because M didn't consider the fact they might have heard of him in North Korea. She's like, oh no, nuts. What do you mean he's stuck in North Korea? The surfboard's okay, they're Armani.
Yeah, wasn't the surfboard retrieved? 20 million, those fiberglass boys. It's really hard to keep something floating and have guns in it. Tough. MI6 spent a lot of money on that. Retrieve those. Let's just smash through this. Okay, so James Bond. It's insane. He's trading diamonds. As he's trading diamonds, again, mere seconds after he's pretending to not be James Bond, the guy at the phone goes, he's James Bond. They go, shit. Then James Bond decides to blow up the diamonds. Now, this is a pivotal moment because the diamonds blow up. They then get embedded into a man's face.
We'll call him Diamond Face for the viewer at home.
Very glad, because that's all my notes. So that's Diamond Face. Now, the main man, who's the sort of the son of like the North Korean general who's trying to establish this deal. Let me just get his name 2 seconds.
Sorry, you're on a roll. I'll let you go.
Zhao, who's trying to initiate this deal, his diamonds are blown up. His second in command is now Diamond Face, and his father has seen from the far that there's fire. So he's like, kill Mr. James Bond.
So the producers have clearly gone, all right, what haven't we done in a James Bond film before? Have we done hover cars? We haven't done hover cars? Throw in some hover cars in North Korea. Because we get a hover car chase. And it's nuts.
I'll say it right now, it's fun. I was reading all the reviews for this, and everyone's like, ugh, it sucks, but I'll tell you what, that start fucking slaps, and it fucking does. We get Diamond Face angry. We get a hovercraft chase. I've never seen that in a film. Mm. It's massive.
It's a shame that after this sequence, the whole movie trades in this really fun, fast-paced, practical action for hyper CGI, boring chases.
It is like, a shame, isn't it?
It's the best action sequence in the film, And I think I would forgive the movie so much more if all the action sequences were of this level.
Yeah.
But they decided to get way more cartoonish.
They were like, we got a fucking 40 acres, we got 40 hover carts and a lot of explosives. Let's just see what happens. Anyway, our boy Zhao, it's insane. Pretty much they're on a hover cart, there's a flamethrower. So interesting. Go seek out the movie or listen to us explain it. Flamethrower, it's all sick. James Bond crashes it into, like, I assume a holy temple, jumps onto a bell, and Zhao crashes to his end. James Bond's like, haha, saved by the bell. He's then immediately tortured for that joke. He's tortured, he's waterboarded. And Carl, if you're getting waterboarded, what's the best transition then?
I don't know. Maybe a sexy woman strolls out in the water, swimming around. You're like, huh, what? What's happening? I guess I'll die. Another day. Another day. I guess I'll go another way. Another way, because I will die. Another day.
Holy shit, another is Madonna day. In the room? I think she's here. And congratulations to Madonna for being a second appearance in Who Would Watch This? Cannot believe she's done my least favorite song and movie. She's...
No. Here's the thing, though. It's an awful song, but it kind of slaps.
Kind of slaps, and I'll say right now, it fits the film perfectly. If you see Pierce Brosnan getting waterboarded, then you hear Madonna going, another day, I'm gonna die, another day. You're in it. You're in the mood.
It's crazy nobody, like, they must have given this opening sequence to so many effects houses to do the opening graphics on, because there's no consistency between... Somebody was like, okay, we're going to have this whole, like, fire versus ice vibe, and somebody's like, scorpions. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Mm-hmm. What was that? Sorry, scorpions? No, we got this, like, fire and ice thing. It doesn't really work. We have
animals. Lightning. When they touch, there'll be lightning.
Hang on, we can't have an extra element.
Scorpions and lightning?
Stinging and, like, electric...
But they're all women.
Sexy or, like, not sexy? So which one?
They're in heels.
So am I aroused, or is it still the fire and the ice?
Well, I'm aroused, but that's from the scorpion.
Are you in? Okay, so it's a scorpion fetish. So if you have a scorpion fetish, is it attractive?
But the fire and the ice.
Okay, cool. All right, well, we'll approve this and give you $30 million. Madonna's coming in to re-record the lines.
Madonna?
We got Madonna for this? Is scorpion scat porn? Oh, fantastic.
Scrap the scorpions. No, don't scrap. Oh, add more scorpions.
Have the scorpions sting the ice. That arouses me. Ugh. Especially to attract a Madonna.
I think it's wild to graphically... torture your protagonist with a Madonna song playing. That is an iconic opening for James Bond. And then to say that he withstood it for 16 months? 16 months!
It's crazy. You think, oh, how's he gonna get out of this one? He doesn't. In my brain now, Madonna is now a very eclectically she's associated with torture. I've seen Swept Away and I've seen this. In my mind, if I see Madonna, I'm gonna, like, freak out. I'm gonna think I'm gonna get waterboarded. Because that's just how I associate
it. She's Jigsaw and Saw. That's a fun fact.
Yeah. Oh, wow. She nailed that role.
You want to play a game? Play a game. Do you want to play a game?
How whack is that? 16 months. My jaw dropped. Just.
Oh, it was insane.
I was like,
oh my god.
He has, like, a scraggly beard.
There's nothing wrong with him. He just grew a beard. They were like, oh god, that was some good quality torture, guys. I guess I'm Santa now.
I'll say it. I'm going to say it. The North Koreans kind of pussied out in the torture. No way he's this unharmed after, like, 16 months. He should be fucked up, I think, quite frankly.
They free him, and he happily jumps off a boat and swims to shore.
Mm.
And I'm like, are you not mentally scarred? Super how did you even sleep that night? How are you out in large spaces? You haven't been outside for 16 months.
We are torture experts, so we know what to expect after 14 months of torture. We both have lived through it. So I don't know why he's so acclimatized. Like, well, Let me check my surroundings. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to re-enter society.
They're basically like, hey, are you ready to go? And he's like, oh, okay, let me grab my things. All right, so I've got this.
My
got
raggedy
doll
ash.
I talked to for a month.
My wife, she was lovely.
I love him turning around being like, can all my friends come with me? And they're like, there's nobody around you. Then they can come. And he's just got like personality disorder the rest of the film. And Em's like, we shouldn't have sent him into North Korea with surfboards. We were wrong. It's ruined him.
She's smoking the same cigarette. That was a bad one. Okay, that's on us.
I swear I'll make better judgment calls the rest of the movie. Spoilers, she doesn't.
Okay, so pretty much James Bond has been swapped for Diamond Face. Now, Diamond Face has now become Diamond Face because the diamonds are embedded in his, like, half his face. He's like Two-Face,
there's
but like
gotta be
Gucci.
About... Gucci face. I love... There's probably like $30 million worth of diamonds in this guy's face.
Do you think... I feel like you could pick him out. I'll say it.
I thought so too. I reckon if you put his thumb in his mouth and blew, they'd just pop out.
Yeah, it'd be a fun party trick. I think he should have attempted it. But yeah, they get traded.
I love the fact that it happened and he's like, this is just a defining trait. And now I've got like a party story.
I will say this about James Bond. I do love their commitment to just having fucked up villains. Just a dude with something fucked up. And they're so unstoppable. Like Jaws? What the hell is that?
Isn't Jaws incredible? I always loved my favorite thing in Spectre was like, and we've got our most fucked up villain yet, Dave Bautista. And it's like, oh, is there anything wrong with him? No, it's just Dave Bautista. And isn't that fucked up enough?
Look at him. He's fucked up. He doesn't look like a normal man. He just looks strange. He's too muscly.
I love the idea. He came in for the audition and Sam Mendes was like, oh god, you're awful. You're perfect. Like, Jesus, you're hideous.
You're perfect for fucking fucked up fucker. That's perfect. It's what we need.
I love the script is like, a gross, gross man enters the frame. Oh, you'll be perfect. Look at, oh, and you're sweaty too. Get a bowler hat on him. He'll look great.
Judi Dench, after 14 months of torture, is pretty much like, we didn't want you. Didn't need you. We don't want you. And James Bond's like, I'm ready for action. She's like, we have nothing for you to do. So he's like, right, I'm gonna go off in a huff.
It's so good. She's like, fine, the best thing I can do is you beat up these innocent surgeons that are trying to bring you back to health and you fucking yeet out of here. And he's okay then.
How cruel is that? They're like, let's just check his vials, okay. For like 16 months of torture and James Bond fakes a heart attack. The doctors try and relive him. He then goes, psych, gets the defibrillator and just fucking goes at them. They're in shock. They're upset and he runs out.
He goes up to one woman and is like, thanks for the mooch, sugar tits, and clicks at her and dives off the boat. And you're like, oh my god, you've just beaten up these poor... Especially because we're in the middle of like a pandemic, you can't have more. You've got so much respect for surgeons at the moment and doctors that the idea that they're like, we've got to resuscitate him, somebody's like, just punches their way out. And M's just like, yeah, I orchestrated that, sorry. Not a great call.
He pretty much grabs a nurse, wet willies her, and just farts on her face. Just like, this is what I think about your profession. And you're like, James, you just cannot do that in 2021.
Pulls her in and whispers in her ear and is just like, I left a present in the, what's the wet pan or whatever? And just under the bed. Just like, left a thick piss and a shit for you under the bed in that pan. Clean that out.
Under the bed, no joke, K, I brought it here, frozen in her face. I sneezed on it too. Suck that up, bitch.
I would then love it if he was just too weak to get away, and he's like, ah.
Can you get me a...
slinkies into himself.
Can someone assist me? I'm so weak due to this virus.
Alright, so he swims to Hong Kong. He's gonna go on his own mission.
does. I always think, and it's
not near it. What?
It's not just this film, because I think, like, I remember Spectre doing it so often. They're just like, hey, we need to go to, I don't know, fuck it, Vietnam, go there for 5 minutes, and then it's like, all right, Switzerland. It's just an elaborate way to go on holiday for these people making the film.
It's one of the things that I think the worst James Bond films screw up, which is they don't consider the fact that I think their best ones are globe-trotting with purpose. And this one, and I think Spectre, and I think Quantum of Solace, all globetrot for the sake of having different locations. Yeah. There's no reason the plot even goes there. It's just bizarre, because as soon as he's in Hong Kong, he, like, yeets to Mexico. Like,
how crazy. Yeah, so he goes to Cuba. But yeah, but, like, it's that. So I was so confused, because I written down, all right, we're in, like, as you say, Hong Kong. And he's like, right, I'm done. Cuba time. Why are we in Cuba, Kyle?
I don't know. The something to do with actually in Hong Kong there's like Hong Kong intelligence, and I don't know how that played into anything.
No, I've got no clue. He goes to a hotel in Hong Kong. He's pretty much like, "Hey, I'm a regular here." He's like in his scrappy torture clothes.
Oh, and it's the funniest thing, because everybody knows him. So he hasn't been seen for 16 months. He's got long hair and a beard, and still people are like, oh, hey, James Bond, you're back? Like, you're the worst spy possible for any mission.
Insane. Because then he gets brought up to, like, the hotelier's like, up we go. And then he's like, I've brought you a masseuse. And James Bond, our protagonist, fucking strangleholds the masseuse, shoots the mirror, and they're just like, you're trying to kill me. And he's like, we were. All right, now pop off to Cuba. What the fuck was that?
It's so jarring, because it's another thing that about this movie that's really weird is that it's basically, I think the opening 14 minutes is pretty important.
Mm.
Then it pretty much treads water for 50 minutes before it introduces the villain. And I don't know what happens in between the villain being introduced and the opening sequence that couldn't be so easily condensed. During this time, he goes to like three different worldly locations.
How crazy is that, right?
Just to figure out that it's odd, but it's just to find out that diamonds are still circulating and there's face changing technology, and we meet Halle Berry's character.
Yeah.
That takes 50 minutes.
You'd be pissed if, like, I don't know. I always feel like especially with this film, it feels like they shot 4 hours worth of stuff. Like, I feel like there's a big part in, like, Cuba. They were like, let's film around it, and they're like, we don't need it. So we're in Cuba, right?
Yeah, I don't, like, I really can't fathom what's happening in Cuba.
Oh, sorry, actually, no. Like, I don't really know what's going on in Cuba. It's so messy. Essentially, this guy who was, like, part of the Cuban Revolution is pretty much like, hey, we're doing pretty well. See over there, that little island? There's a big hospital there. They're doing some funky shit over there. Better check it out, Bond.
But what did that have to do with Hong Kong?
I've no clue. But Hong Kong. Hong Kong is a mystery to me.
Like, I get that. I think one of the other things he's trying to figure out during this time is that somebody ratted him out in North Korea.
Yes, that is probably what he's trying to figure out. I guess Hong Kong is technically close to North Korea. But, like, never in these films are they like, oh, geographically they're close. It's never an issue.
But I don't know why, like, I don't get how he was ratted out. Like, he was just bad at his mission and got caught.
Oh, yeah, he was the fact that he was sitting, like, there for 16 months going, who ratted me out? Bro, you walked in with a surfboard, shot everybody, and was like, now...
He had sunglasses on. His disguise was sunglasses.
Yeah.
You went in like a fucking Chad. Like,
he didn't even bring the sunglasses. He stole the sunglasses from the hostage. I'm like, well, thank God he brought these. I was boned if I didn't have these. Yeah, he ratted out bullshit. He got fucked over. Anyway, so now he's in Cuba. Now there's a little hospital, a secret hospital on an island. Now we're established in, like, this gross, cockney, like, Cuban revolutionary that James Bond's like, I dislike you. He then beats him up, puts him in a wheelchair, And because this guy has a ticket to, like, the hospital on an island, the guards, like, let him through. This man brings a wheelchair, like, Cuban revolutionary on, like, onto the boat. And then the first second of danger, he just throws him on the ground.
he rams the chair into a wall and is like, ah! And I don't know why that's, like, if you saw somebody ram a wheelchair man into a wall, you chase the assaulter. You don't get to... You're not like, oh god, what the fuck's this whole situation that's unfolding? I guess 30 of us are distracted now. Like,
But
he creates more of a scene to get chased than he does a distraction.
Because it's not like it's guards. It's just, again, nurses. And he's constantly just like, what's that? He's an old man on the ground. And he pretty much kicks a nurse and then runs off.
Oh, he fights. He just goes out of his way to hit as many nurses and doctors as he can to get to the face technology.
He's just like, all right, the room's over there. I've got 50 meters. There's quite a few nurses. I guess these fists are going to have to do a lot of work, and bam, bam, bam.
How dare you help people for a small amount of money? What, did you train for years? Oh, I'm an alcoholic.
Oh. It's Cuba too. Like, oh my god, how bad is that? Just an American rookie. Oh, he's British technically, but fuck off.
I love that. Just like, oh, I'm all for doctors' rights, and then giving them a left.
Oh my god. Okay, so he finds out that they're doing DNA
altering with diamonds.
No,
or to
not
help transport diamonds.
Okay, I guess so, but technically they're two separate things. Essentially, the guys like that like to transport diamonds have figured out that you can change your face with DNA. Now, who else might be wanting to know that other than MI6? While it's the NSA.
NSA. The fuck is the NSA? He's like, hey, you CIA? And she's like, no, I'm NSA. And I'm like, just fucking make a CIA. It's not like I'm going to go to stretch that the CIA would send her. I don't know what the fuck in the NSA is. Like,
how dare you, ignorant fuck. They're the ones that stole all our information.
She's really the villain.
Yeah, essentially. I'm always rooting for the good guys, and it's never James Bond.
It's James Bond is just the antagonist to so many people that are just trying to change the world for the better. Like, he's like, everybody should listen to the British. Stab, stab. Like,
if history has proven one thing, the British imperialism has nailed world geopolitics. Just keep on listening and it will stay stable. That has never failed for any continent.
So Diamond Face is there to get reconstructed. He runs away. Jinx, who's NSA, played by Halle Berry, she jumps off a cliff that is the tallest cliff I've ever seen. Like a 40, 50-story building.
Looked it up.
Down into the ocean.
The world record is 50 meters for jumping off a building and surviving. So she's dead.
Especially because the water looked insanely shallow. Like, she just jumped onto a beach.
Yeah. Pretty much just like...
She aimed for the rocky stuff. She's getting oystered up and everything. I'd love it if she came back in the movie just fucking sliced to shit. She's like, the NSA dropped my health. Like, I can't get anywhere.
The North Koreans got fixed up diamond face. My goddamn body's fucked up. Truly a comment
all
on the American healthcare
Cuba
system.
Were beaten up.
Yeah, someone defiled all the nurses and doctors, and I could not get any help. James, who could have done this?
So many broken jaws, everybody was worse than me. Cuba's left without a single healthcare worker. Do you know what happened?
Who defiled every Cuban nurse and doctor in the 50-kilometer radius? Who could have done that? James Bond wiping blood off his fist.
So now he's like, let's go to London because I want to find the biggest diamond trader in the world.
Mm.
And so we meet basically Nigel Thornberry.
You pretty much nailed it.
He's so British. It's the most British, like, man that they could have found.
How do we get introduced to Gustav Graves?
Oh, Is that his name?
His name is Gustav Graves. Which doesn't sound British, right, so, but he's pretty much a royal.
A bunch of people are waiting for him to rock up, and they're like, God, he's late. And then Rosamund Pike is just like, actually, he's right on time. And he just does like a 40-minute skydiving, just circling around, slowly making his way. I'd be like, oh, this is not worth it to get coverage. For some people, as soon as he lands, all these reporters need to ask him heavy-hitting questions like, some say you don't sleep, do you?
He's like, you know, I don't. And then gets in the car. Don't waste your time parachuting. Elaborate. What the hell do you mean you don't sleep?
I love it because immediately Rosamund Pike's like, and that's enough questions, thank you very much. And I'd just be like, you told me he'd be right on time. He skydived in and answered a sleeping question. You bitch.
With a riddle, too. He was like, you know, those who sleep have time to die. What? You can't just fucking answer that after jumping out of a building?
Why? Why did he even do that jump?
like, sure to, like, so show he's elaborate. But, like, even the Olympics, that seems silly. When James Bond did it for the Olympics, it seemed a bit overdone. When he does it...
Oh, it was fun. It was the Queen.
It was
I liked
the Queen.
When it was the Queen.
It was great.
You're like, you didn't do that jump, but I think you did.
Oh, camera tricks. Incredible. How do they do it?
So this is the thing that really boggles my mind.
Yeah.
Because I've watched this movie a lot of times, and I've never picked up on how important the Sydney Olympics were in this film. So, James Bond goes to a fencing class where the teacher is Madonna, doing an awful performance for a few minutes. Just terrible.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, he wants a gold. She has a gold. Rosamund Pike is a gold-winning medalist from Sydney, Australia Olympics.
Stop it.
Because what's it called? Because the person she was versing OD'd, and thus she won the gold. And then, at the end of the movie, when it's revealed that Rosamund Pike is the other villain, the reason she turned on MI6 is because the villain overdosed the other woman so that she could win the gold at the Sydney Olympics.
It's one of those genius plot points that you blink and you miss it. That's why you need to watch this film twice, apparently, Carl.
I was shocked. Gobsmacked. Did you pick up on any
literally,
of that?
I did not pick up on that at all. I can't believe what you're saying is true.
I was flabbergasted. The amount of times they were like at the Sydney Olympics, and I was like, why do we keep saying this? And then to make it the pivotal turning point at the end when they're like, hey, why are you a bad guy? Well, you see, the fencing at the Sydney Olympics. Like, what?
See... you've given the film, because you've watched it so many times, you've given the film like a chance. When they started just fencing for 20 minutes, I was like, bullshit, there's anything stronger than this. Gustav Graves and James Bond fence for what seems like 20 minutes. They make a fucking mockery of this fencing club. They're just bashing into shit, smashing up shit.
This wouldn't look good on anyone. If this got out on the publications that some rich British dude nearly fenced somebody to death and basically tore apart a building for a bet and then was like, it's all in good fun. Like,
all jolly good and wodger, how about that?
James Bond slices, because the villain's like, should we up the stakes if we're going to play for more money? How about first draw of blood in the torso? Like,
grab sword off the side, James Bond's like, let's fucking go. God, it's a strange one, isn't it?
I don't know why they don't just kill James Bond here.
This movie has
a lot of chances
to kill
for
this
James
man.
Bond to die.
This man should be dead. Also, I don't think we've mentioned it, but there's been about 6 times that James Bond will walk into a room and every woman just gushes. My God, this man! I know he's attractive, but is he that attractive?
you're totally right. Just, there's like a part where Rosamund Pike is sadly making out with him, like, I knew this was going to happen. And I was like, oh, Oh god, that's crushing.
How
you're not even interested in doing this right now. But like, he's probably got like endorphins or something that forces like people to want to feel this way.
He like she's
the
like
the amount of women he fucks, like
she's like sure she's like a double agent, but like she spent what seems like 15 years working hard, nose down. She's like, I've never had a relationship, and James Bond's like, you're gonna fuck me. She's like, yeah, I know.
It's also like the scene which she is like, we're gonna fuck. He's also like mid-mission, like he stops doing what he's doing to go back to the room and fuck. And then continues the, like, it's an 80-minute detour for him to do that. And then, like, he's in the middle of doing something else.
It takes him so long to get hard, too. He's just, like, stroking it by himself. Just like, shut up, Roseman. Tell me I'm pretty. Tell me I'm 007.
He's like, it's not my fault. Do you see how fucking cold it is in here? Everything's ice.
I'm bigger normally, you dumb bitch. Now tell me I'm hot.
All right, so should we just get to the Ice Palace?
Real quickly, because I fucking hate this scene, like, pretty much so much. Essentially, midway through, like, just this happening, James Bond's, like, starts shooting people. You're like, what's going on? And then John Cleese, out of fucking nowhere, grabs our screen and takes off sunglasses. Like, we're meant to be wearing 3D glasses at that second. And then's like, huh, you like our VR headset? Walk with me, Bond. And Bond's like, ugh. And John Cleese is like, all right, here's a ring. It can smash glass. Here's a car. It's invisible. I can't believe
this is in the car
film.
We're going to get to. The invisible car is...
heinous. Heinous.
It's so awful.
So bullshit. It's like having, like... You can't bring an invisibility cloak into a film that's meant to be serious.
Oh, I'm just going to say it right now. Also, the car's not invisible. Like, every time he uses it, you can see the fucking car. Like, it doesn't even do
it. It's like a floppy ghost walking through shit. How dare nobody see it?
Oh my god, there's a part where he goes to use it, and it so clearly outlines our full fucking car that to the point when somebody walks into it, I'm like, you know what, it's your own fucking fault. Honestly. Well, I don't even know how James Bond got the car to the Ice Palace. Why was it even there on the mission?
No clue. Also, if they have this technology, use it. You have invisibility. What is this car running? It must be abusing petrol.
It must... It's also... It takes about 3 shots of bullets before it's like, oh, the invisibility's down. Like, oh, what the fuck is this invention?
But it's not like it's broken. It's just like, I need a recharge. I need a bit of me time to get back in the mood.
I know, right? It's like, oh, sorry, we're in the desert. I need solar panels. I'm a Tesla. Like, give me some time to recharge. And then when you think I'm invisible, I'll be a stark sketched outline of a car that you can see anyway. Like, fucking hell, this is stupid.
I dislike John. Strange John Cleese is in this, right? Again, second approval for him. Pluto Nash, look at him. This is a film is ticking off people.
He's obsessed with cars. Remember when he was a car? That was fun. It's weird that Judi Dench was kept from this into the other James Bond films.
I was going to say, how long has she been M for?
Well, she's been M since GoldenEye. So that was ages ago.
That's like...
So, I'm really glad they kept her. I think like, I'm glad they were like, fuck the continuity. Yeah, she's always good. It's Judi Dench.
Well, like, I've heard that, like, the theory that, like, 007 just swaps people when he dies. So, like, he's just, like, a name. You ever heard of that? Mm. So I kind of like that.
Because the new one is he's not a 007 anymore. And this is what everybody got upset about is because he's retired.
Mm.
A black woman is now 007.
Gotcha.
And people were like, you can't make a black woman James Bond. And it's like, well, she's not James Bond. She's 007 because there's like 10 00s.
Yeah, it's the title.
Like, I don't know. I don't know why you'd get so upset.
just vibe it. I mean, you can't watch this and be like, ugh, come on, keep it serious. It's like, no. No. John Cleese handed him like VR porn headset. Like we're not real in this universe.
So yeah, Ice Palace. Why are they here? Why does it exist?
They kept name dropping Iceland throughout the film. Like fuck off. we're in North Korea. Why are we in Iceland? And this is where the film pretty much is now for a bit. We're in an ice palace that looks
like the next hour. It's yeah, here. It's weird.
It's pretty much an entire ice hotel. Have you ever been to those ice bars?
No, because they look fucking stupid.
Oh, they're ridiculous.
That's why.
They're so overpriced. You buy one beer for like 20 euros and then you get your pitcher and then you leave.
20 euros?
Normally it's a beer with the price and then you leave. You can't get drunk because you're in line for an hour. They're atrocious. Ooh. And then their whole hotel is there.
Sounds stupid. This is stupid.
And yet we're here for an hour, Carl. It feels like,
Oh, we're here for the rest of the movie. It's weird.
Yeah.
Also, because he swims underneath the hotel at one point, it's, like, structured on the thinnest, flimsiest piece of ice. Like, it's about an inch thick, and it's like, hey, a whole hotel is on here.
Not even a whole hotel. Their whole base of operations, essentially. This is like, they have a satellite that, like, can control the sun.
Why are we here? Do you know?
No, I have no clue. Like, I think it just looks cool, right?
He gets invited? Maybe, but it's open to the public, I think. But it's only him and then just a shit ton of villains. Like, everybody's a henchman, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
Like, who's living here? Who's this for?
I have no clue.
Why is there a green room?
Well, I assume, what's it called? Our boy Gustav sort of lives here because he's got this weird... He has a coach where he drives... I can only describe it as like a pod racer from Star Wars. What is that?
That's pretty accurate, actually.
It's just like... It's like a plane? I don't know, like on the ground that goes really fast.
It's so funny. They're like, hey, this is going to sit here with the keys in the ignition at all times.
How much does it cost? I don't know,
if anybody else wants to use it.
Yay, you have fun with it. We're establishing it now so it can be used later. Whatever.
I know it snows out here, but I'm going to leave the hood open. And you know what? Let's open up all the convertibles. All the convertibles.
Fuck it. Turn those heated seats up. Just get it nice and warm. If anyone wants to put a little button there, they can go for it.
Run your batteries dead, people. Let's get us stranded. We'll have a party.
Does anyone have jumper leads? No. Good. Let's keep it that way.
There's no electricity out here. Everything's fucking ice. You'll electrocute yourself.
Yeah, you put one fucking cord. That's right. There'll be no fucking... Oh, what a pointless, stupid... Anyway.
Also, why are there hot springs? How are there hot springs?
I don't know. I mean, like, I can... Well, here's the thing. I would give them the benefit of the doubt. Like, oh, it's a volcanic thing. Like, you know how that happens in some Arctic places. But we can... James Bond goes under the water. There's no fucking volcanic thing. It's just like a hot tub in the middle of the ocean, this jungle thing.
So, we're here. What's it called? So now we find out that the villain's plan is that he is harnessing the sun with a satellite named Icarus.
Mm-hmm.
And what's he going to do with the laser beam?
Well, originally he's like, hey, how cool, I guess to investors, hey, how cool is it that it can be sunny wherever we want? And I guess every global superpower was like, that's a cool use of an individual's money and time. We're not going to intervene at all.
But... Yeah, so up until that point, I guess that's what we know his plan is.
Yes, but actually, it's got a massive laser on it.
So, we're just here, we're vibing, Jinx is back, who knows why. James Bond fucks Rosamund Pike, then he's like, hey, I'm gonna go confront the villain. The villain's like, Rosamund Pike works for me. James Bond's like, what? Oh no! I'll shoot the floor with my laser ring.
My ring that John Cleese gave me. Tap it on the ground, smashes the glass, doesn't it?
It's so funny because I think it's the first time he uses it and then he clearly seems addicted to its power the rest of the movie. He's just fucking touching everything with the ring, being like, explode, explode, shatter, shatter, shatter.
He's like walking to an art museum and going, oh, fuck, I'm going to touch all the fucking artwork. I'm going to fucking, oh, wet paint, fucking give me a little freaking hand on that bad boy.
He fucking walks into a store, clicks his fingers and is like, we got some glassware in here. Direct me to an aisle. Like,
let's just say I'm a little bull and this is a goddamn China shop and I'm just gonna frigging go crazy in here.
Immediately a cashier would be like, you're James Bond, aren't you? No, I've heard about what you did at Big W. Get out.
That's
get
fucked
out.
Up.
You made a mess.
You punched that nurse and then you touched everything. It was weird.
You've crippled our health system and now you're coming for our fine China. Get out.
We can, listen, I'll draw the line at the nurses. You can do whatever you want to them. But when you come for the fine China, get the fuck out of here.
So James Bond tries to escape. He jumps into, oh, well, what do you know? The keys were left in the ignition and the hood's open of the very fast vehicle the villain left around. So James Bond jumps into it. The villain's like, I know what will kill him. A beam from the sun. And everybody's like, okay, cool. Are you going to put the beam where the car is going to go? No, I'll put it where the car has been. So it just travels slowly behind the car. Never catching
up. I can't believe he's like, let's have a chase. It's like, no, you have a laser from space. You've won. You've won. There's no fucking competition. How do you mess this up?
It's so innovative and clever how James Bond gets out of the situation. How does he get out of the situation?
Well, it's clever, Carl. You see, this pod racer thing they've just made up for the film has a grappling hook. The grappling hook then catches onto a cliff. He then is now hanging vertically. James Bond looks around at his like pod-like shape. He's like, you know what I've got? All I have at my disposal is a sheet of metal.
Ooh.
He then has a parachute out of nowhere. And then decides to surf the largest wave in all of human history. Carl, this is the only part of the film I'd actually seen. What the? And with the context, I'm more angry. Like,
it's,
what?
It's not it really jumps the shark in just how this looks. And he windsurfs, but it's the wave is making the wind. There's a part where it literally cuts and they're like, oh, he's going up a ramp and he's landed, because they themselves were like, there's no way to film the dynamics of how any of this works.
There's no fucking way of explaining this, like, in a...
He's also... You think he'd be worried. It looks like he's going to just get stuck out in the snow.
He must
freeze
know,
to death.
He must just know he's James Bond, because he's so casually just like... Like, if I was in that situation, if I had the plan, and if I had executed the surfing thing, I'd be shitting myself. There's no way I'm thinking this is going to work. And James Bond's like, well, I'll do this, and then I'll shut down that laser. Simple pimple. One, two. Two-step plan.
Especially because the way that he gets out of it is somebody happens to be going by in a ski mobile, and he kicks him off it. But yeah. I reckon it's so far away from the villain's base that this probably isn't even a villain, but just somebody going for a leisurely ski.
Yeah,
so I reckon he's just stranded.
It's an ice hotel. That's probably just someone having a nice nice hotel, a nice trip. You know, it's probably a nurse on a very scarce.
He's just
a
out
very
there
scarce
like,
holiday.
I smell a health worker out here.
Someone who isn't paid enough. Good, they're gonna get the fucking kicking of a lifetime. I swear to God.
Have you ever saved a life? I thought so. So during this, I don't really give a shit about whatever Jinx is doing in this movie, but one of the things I thought was hilarious.
She's such a damsel, but go on, yeah, what does Halle Berry do?
All four of the villains go to enter a room. So Halle Berry runs up and just high kicks Diamond Face, and they immediately pull out guns on her. She's like, all right, you got me. And I'm like, you had the advantage of the attack, you didn't have a weapon, and you decided to ambush them just with kicking? Just with kicking.
Diamond Face pretty much gets out of his DNA thing like, oh my god, I'm starting to feel like me again, and she just fucking kicks his self-confidence. And then she's like, your mama sent me. How is that a lie? And the guards are like, all right, someone just fucking electrocute her. Quite frankly, she deserves it.
Oh, God. So funny. The villain is then just like, cool, we're going to leave. We're going to jump on a jet. So here's our game plan. We're going to melt this hotel. Why? I don't know. We'll do it anyway. And if you want an example of how useless this weapon is, watch it try to melt this hotel for the next 40 minutes, and it can't. It's a beam from the sun, and it can't melt ice. It's pointless. So pointless. Halle Berry almost drowns in an ice room. It makes no sense. Wouldn't the heat be coming from the ceiling? How does she even have a ceiling to choke against? The room's not airtight. Water needs to escape, so how would anybody have been breathing in the room? None of it makes sense. Why'd they build it if they were going to melt it anyway?
I mean, all I was thinking throughout this film, all this scene was just, you know, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, how they have the chocolate Taj Mahal? All I was thinking was that's their plan, essentially. Build a Taj Mahal out of chocolate and then melt it. What the fuck? Ugh.
Oh, God, sorry. We accidentally skipped over the most important part of the film. It's time for the big reveal as to who our villain is.
Oh my God, but we've already had Roseman Pike. We've already had a double agent, Carl. What else can we bring to the table?
What's the villain's name?
Why, it's Gustav Graves.
Gustav. Interesting name. Is there face technology lingering around by any chance?
I mean, there is, but I can't... Oh, what? No. You don't... Wait, now hang on. Hang on, Carl. Those North Koreans from earlier that haven't showed up since the start of the film? No, Carl. Stop. Stop talking. But I saw him die. No, he died. Are you telling me that Zhao is actually Gustav Graves, who's done DNA tests on his face?
You're telling me the most twee British man in the world is a North Korean? Is that the big twist of the film? Oh, very clever. Very culturally appropriate. This is the most embarrassing writing I've seen in a movie that was like $100 billion.
You're wrong, Carl, because the writers had one issue. They went, we want to blame the North Koreans for terrorism, but we do not want to hire one to play in the movie. How do we get around this?
Right. It's disgusting. It's disgusting they did this. There is a scene where the North Korean dad comes in and places his hand on Gusto's face and is like, my son. And I went, oh. Could you imagine giving that direction to that North Korean actor? How dare you? I'm shocked.
It's almost touching until the second you step back a little bit and it's just there's a white boy to a North Korean dictator like, father? No. Truly, Icarus flew too close to the sun.
It's pretty appalling. Like, this is it's a really appalling... Did you see this coming? Where you were like, it's going to end here. I know this is going to happen.
Listen, like, I'll be honest. Maybe I just wasn't thinking critically at all. But when I heard DNA technology, I just didn't think they would have the balls to introduce this comically English character. Like, so comically English and be like, he's the North Korean. I just didn't even think that could be a possibility.
Because this is the reveal I was hyping up to you, where I was like, the last 30 minutes gets pretty wacky. Like,
am I an idiot for not guessing this?
Like, I don't know. I think it's funny when you know it's coming that when they're in Cuba and they go to see Diamond Face, it's like a shot of Diamond Face for before and then after, and it's like a shot of Eddie Redmayne. Like...
Eddie Redmayne playing Stephen Hawking's like, wow, you nailed that, didn't you?
So I was like, oh, they do foreshadow it by being like, he's in the middle of turning into another... It's like, why can the DNA only turn them into British men?
Also, real quickly, why does diamond eyes get like super white eyes?
I don't know. They kind of kept changing his design.
Right? He looked like, so like...
it was weird.
Like, he just looked like a North Korean man with diamonds in his face. And by the end, he looks like a white walker. Like, it's pretty like... he's also bulked up. It's it's very weird, isn't it?
Yeah, but he also looks fucking fabulous.
Oh, yeah. He's looking pretty spanking. All right. Well, let's just figure this out. Anyway, James Bond pretty much is like, all right, I need to get back. So he jumps back in his invisible car, pretty much just follows them through in his... I can't believe this is, like, the technology. He's won. He has an invisible car. Ugh. Anyway.
Oh, I think we've established it's pretty fucking useless. He might as well just have a car. Like, I love that it's also the Diamond Face's first thought is just, like... somebody crashes into nothing and he's immediately like, ah, invisible car.
Bond's here with an invisible car. Let me get in my car and let's have a drive off. This drive off, I think, is cool. I'll say it now. I don't care what you say. I think it's cool.
I will let you have your own opinion.
Cool. I will take that. I will say... what, I
mean, you dumb fuck! I can't believe that you would say this.
I say it's cool. I say this now. Like, I think a 10-year-old me would have thought this is sick. Diamond Face like flips the car. He flips the car, and James Bond like, well, better use the injector seat. Flips it, jumps over a missile. That's the coolest thing I've ever seen. Diamond Face pretty much they pretty much driving around the Ice Kingdom as it's getting like melted. Halle Berry smacking on the walls.
It's so clearly somebody spray painted a car park white. Like, it just ramps and curves around. Like, it's so clearly...
they go through like a bollard that's been sprayed white, just like tickets in. Just like...
oh yeah, you can see it. They go through somewhere where there's like A3 spray painted, so you know what section you're in. So Halle Berry almost drowns. James Bond saves her. He's like, I don't have time to get out of the car. I'll just shatter the windscreen because I love my ring.
She ragdolls so comically, doesn't she? She's like fucking flies out. He pretty much grabs her from the windshield, throws her in the front seat. It's like, all right, well, fucking later. We're going to fuck so hard.
He jumps into a hot spring, and then seconds into the hot spring jump, it's like, oh, we're done and dusted with Iceland. Like,
how crazy
I was like,
is that?
You guys... teleport around the world.
They just fuck off to South Korea. Real quickly though, Diamond Face gets smashed by a chandelier clashing on him.
You know what? It was unavoidable.
It was unavoidable.
He didn't go to the left.
Yeah, that's how it happens.
Or the right. Or forwards or backwards. He just stands.
He just didn't do the thing.
Very still.
He didn't do the thing.
I also thought it was very sinister, considering Diamond Face had clearly lost, and James Bond was like, just gonna shoot a chandelier down on you.
And just
finish
it.
The job.
Yeah, fucking just just abusively kill you.
Do you know why? It's because it turned out Diamond Face had a doctorate.
Stop it. Now that's the real twist of the movie. You know what's a bigger twist of the movie? Michael Madsen is in this.
Yeah, being generic USA Agent 1.
Yeah.
I'm angry about things. Why? I don't know!
The British. I wanna beat them. We gotta beat the nukes. Anyway, so yeah. So James and Halle Berry go to South Korea, the demilitarized zone. Michael Madsen's just like, alright, here's the gist. If that massive laser gets anywhere near the South Korean border, we're gonna fuck shit up. We're gonna go American on those fucking North Korean boys, and we're gonna fucking kill them.
So what's the villain's plan? He just wants to make a road so that the mines, by the war, are gone.
Yeah, so in the militarized zone, there's like a bunch of mines. Essentially, you can't get through it. And his plan is to spray the sun on the military zone so then the North Korean people can cross into their land. But essentially, I mean, I don't know much about geopolitics, but it feels like if it's just for the North, I feel like they're going to get... the whole world's fucked. It's World War III. It's all fucked up.
But also, what's wrong with that plan? He just wants to build a road.
Yeah, truly, he's trying to harmonize the world. And yet the American and British coming and go, you know what, we like it's all messy.
Like, It seems like a non, like it seems an issue for the British to keep their nose out of.
Carl, I don't know if you know about imperialism, but we love our nose just friggin' sniffling around. We just love it all up in its shit.
Anyway, so they're on a plane, begins to crash.
Gustav comes out to his father's like, hey, I'm actually,
He's in this weird fucking suit. He's like, don't I look cool?
Oh.
Look how cool I am.
The film.
I got electric hands.
I can't stress this enough. The film turns into Star Wars. Essentially, all the North Koreans start wearing like black, like Nazi, like iconography. I'll say it right now. Let's just go through the list of things that are Star Wars. I have a list. So
go.
The villain has electrical powers because Gustav built an electrical thing. The main villain changes his body to a mech suit. All the villains are wearing Nazi stuff. They're all in like a frosty villain base, Hoth base. A bunch of sword fights, Death Star satellite, father-son element. I feel like it's Star Wars for the end of it, and James Bond is somehow Luke Skywalker and like the Empire.
I think you're incredibly right. Now that you've pointed that out, I'm like, one of the prequel movies must have come out around this film.
It was.
But they were like, add some of that.
2002. It's got like the most like Phantom Menace is popping off. Chuck a bit of that in there.
The plane gets like a hole in it, and people don't fly out of the hole. They just kind of roll out of the plane.
Yeah, they're sick of this
film. They're like... Somebody's like, and somersault, oh no, a teddy bear roll. Like, off I go.
And I'm done with this film, I'm done.
Yeah, the, what's it called? Rosamund Pike gets stabbed in the chest with a Bible book.
How weird is that?
Halle Berry.
Yeah, Halle Berry froze a dagger with a Bible in it already?
I don't know, I think, is that her, like, finishing move? She's like, I've always got a handful of Bible stabby books on me. One, two, three!
With the power of Jesus. What is this? Is this, like, a metaphor? Was she, like, a sinner? Was she, like, a religious person?
Icarus flew too close to the sun. And as we all know, that
Jesus
is from
also
the Bible.
Flew too close to the sun. I'll say it right now, that boy was pretty wacky. Trying to save everybody. That's why he got crucified.
Yep.
Truly, Jesus is the first Icarus, second Icarus. When was Icarus?
Big fan of religion in this podcast. I like when Noah
builds the boat. Love that.
Yep. I don't know. I only saw the Russell Crowe one. So all I know is that Logan Lerman has a crush on his sister.
That's what I got. That's the gist I get from Christianity. That's the gist, right? That's pretty much it.
All right, so all the villains die, James Bond prevails, but before the film ends, we get to see Moneypenny fingering herself to a VR.
Who's Moneypenny? I have no fucking clue. Essentially, this film, like, it ends, it's like this nice climatic thing, and then this woman who works, like, in HR, James Bond just starts fucking hard on the table, and then John Cleese again walks up to my screen, takes off the glasses, and she's just fucking rubbing the clit, just getting really deep in there.
It's one of those scenes where you're like, you'd think this would be like an end credit stinger. I don't know why it's actually in the film.
It's weird, isn't it? Because I thought the film ended with this VR porn headset bit, and I was like, it'd be weird if Infinity War ended like that. Tony Stark just jacking it to like Pepper Pops.
It just like ends on James Bond being like, and in the end, I got Halle Berry's pussy, and like the credits roll. And you're just like, what a weird fucking movie. It was one of those things where I realized that only post the James Brosnan era did they actually have proper character arcs for James Bond in those films. Before then, it's like,
he was just a dude that fucked.
Everything revolves around
him. Yeah, he just fucked. That's
it's as Miranda Frost puts it, he fucks for breakfast and
kills
for
dinner.
Can't
believe that's a line. Rosamund Pike's, she's, thank God she's done better, but oh my word.
Oh God, I love when you know an actor's career is yet to peak.
Oh yeah.
Like, and you're watching a movie and you're like, oh, you're going to get Gone Girl and you're going to be fucking phenomenal.
Yeah.
And you're going to have like a place in cinema as like one of the best villains. Like, you're going to be, oh. Like, I'm just like, you're going to be so good in so many things after this film. You've just got to get through it, Rosamund. Get through it, Rosamund. Through go it. For gold. Oh,
and she nails it. Anyway, that's the film.
Any final thoughts on your part?
I cannot believe this is what James Bond used to be. I think I've been blessed with the new ones. I was like, Quantum Solace isn't that much. This is bombastic. I can't believe people sat down and went,
yeah.
But it's fun. I'll say that right now.
It is fun. I remember this is why I liked it as a kid. Is I was like, it's basically a cartoon and it moves at a quick pace.
Yeah, definitely. I'll say right now, it feels like, I can't believe this and Austin Powers must have come out the same. Austin Powers came out before this. And then the people writing it must have gone, let's just sort of do that. It feels weird.
I think Austin Powers famously came out on the alternating years a James Bond film didn't.
Because it came out like 1997? Was that the first one?
Yeah. So I think it was like a Brosnan film, Austin Powers, Brosnan, Powers, Brosnan,
Stop
Powers.
Stop it. That's so funny. Because they feel like this one tonally. Because I feel like everything, like this almost feels like it's mocking like what it is.
It's weird that they didn't always have just a British actor be James Bond.
It is weird, isn't it? Because he's so American in this.
Yeah. So
constantly
American.
They're just like, don't work with those American scum. It's like, it's you.
It is nice that they kind of took a step back and were like, we're going to try and make these like heightened British pop culture. Like they... I get that. I think Casino Royale was made by an American, but I kind of like that they had like some Brits come in and work some magic.
I will also say this. So. I mean, maybe it's just because this film's old and maybe the actors that are in it aren't as big now, but I like the Daniel Craig ones because I feel like the massive actors in this one kind of detract from it a little bit. Like, I kind of like this, just Daniel Craig.
That's a good point.
And the rest of the other ones are like kind of, not nobodies, but they're, you know... They're just, like, doing it for the...
Yeah, it's like, Naomi Harris isn't, like, raking in dough at the box office.
Exactly.
And a lot of those other actors, yeah. Which I think was my disappointment with Christoph Waltz,
yeah.
Inspector, was I just thought he was too big of an actor.
And, like, it like for what they were trying to do, they were like, oh, he controlled all the villains. But it's like, yeah, but you weren't as good as all those guys.
Also, because I think Javier Bardem could have been too big for Skyfall, but he's such a good villain in that movie that he overcomes.
Oh, 100%. That fucking jaw reveal. Yeah. Oh my, good stuff.
Ah, love it. Love it. Same with like, how early did they get Mads Mikkelsen?
Oh my god.
For like that Casino Royale.
But I love it.
Considering how much his career was yet to be.
100%.
He's so good.
But he's not like a good villain. That's the best part. He's kind of fucking up quite a bit. He puts it all in a poker game.
Yeah, that's the whole... Yeah, like the... Yeah, that... Casino Royale's so good.
So good. Crazy this came out. They were like, let's just fucking do it better. Guys, come on.
Okay, Oscar, who would watch Die Another Day?
Okay, well, I guess it's not for James Bond fans. It seems like no one wants this. And I can't say you. Listen, it's if you want, essentially, I know Austin Powers 4 isn't coming out for a while. If you want that, watch this. This is pretty much it. It's pretty much towing the line of like a spy film with some fun action, and it seems like a comedy at points, honestly.
Out of all of the James Bond films before Casino Royale, this is the one I return to the most. It's the one I have seen the most out of all those old ones. I think if you want a reflection of what James Bond movies were like, you've basically just got to watch like Dr. No, Honor Her Majesty's Secret Service, GoldenEye and this.
Pretty much.
And then just do the Daniel Craigs and you'll be sweet. So it's for people that want to just quickly tick through James Bond movies without having to watch all 30 of them.
Yeah, get the tone down packed pretty quick. You can kind of see like, this is him at his goofiest. He's very goofy in this.
Okay, Oscar, what are we reviewing next week?
Next week we're doing the third XXX film. That's right, XXX.
the return of Xander Cage.
So excited. Tune in next week. Thank you for listening.
Absolutely hyped.
To say the least.
Yeah, thank you for listening.